You see, when that was the challenge, this is actually IFRS 9 relates to your accounting treatment and having those losses and incomes appropriately measured. But there was a convention, and there is a convention under which capital was also required to be maintained under those rules. At that time, BIS and State Bank were very aggressive in terms of implementing the advanced approaches, and at that time, if I recall, a standardized approach of capital calculation was considered to be the very basic, and generally banks told or said that it is very easy to implement, and when it actually came implementation, it took them 2 to 3 years to actually implement those simplistic form of calculations. If you see globally and in Pakistan, the reason for estimating capital requirement based on complex risk estimates has gone away. They have not actually, the regulators are not promoting or requiring the banks to base their capital requirements on these complex models, because the more complex the models are, the more easy it is to tweak them and get the desired results. This is the biggest challenge in Basel II implementation, and what I see the biggest challenge ahead of us in Pakistan, if it is implemented, would be the standardization of those models. Because yes, you want to base your provisions on your risk levels, which your risk measurement system measures. But the risk measurement systems are also not aligned. At times you see loans classified as the best rated one are all of a sudden gets into an 8 or 9 category. So this actually shows the robustness of the models being used by the bank. And it would be very dangerous if our PD, LGD and EAD estimations are both based on, are primarily based on those models which are not as robust, non-standardized, more non-granular at a higher level. So differentiation in the banks in terms of maintaining or managing different models will also influence the sophistication and also the roadmap of the regulator for IFRS 9 implementation in Pakistan.
So, Amin, I think in terms of the, because we hear that from you as well, that there are various factors or judgmental factors in the determination of ECL provisions. So in terms of the central bank role, what do you expect in terms of the guidelines that should come to the bank sector so that a certain level of consistency and robustness can be achieved in implementing the IFRS 9?
Yeah, I think the definition of default is something which is very important. State banks should define what should be the default. And secondly, the macroeconomic variables, so which should be inside the model. And the third is the pricing. Like when you talk about ratings, I think the rating model in the bank is correct. But probably when they price somebody, the rating is completely different. When they go for Basel, it's something which is different. So I think internally, the business pricing ratings and the risk management ratings are different, because I think that has to be merged. And UAE has and Qatar has actually has given detailed guidelines to make IFRS 9 implementation consistent. And I think what they are doing is they are following prudential regulation and IFRS 9, and whichever is higher. So from that angle, your prudential provision will never be, your IFRS 9 provision will never be lower than PR. So that's, I think that is the way we should implement IFRS 9. And delaying this IFRS will actually, because you know, like people are expecting that the economy will go up in this year only. So deferring the IFRS 9 will actually hinder the acquisitions which are expected in future, which will affect the overall economy of Pakistan.
Okay. So I think let's try to take some questions as well, so that we have participation from the gathering.
So when we look at the balance sheet of a bank, the asset side has two major components that contains loans and advances portion and the investment portions. Till now we are talking about the credit risk. This is one of the part of the our asset sides. We haven't discussed about the counterparty risk, how the banks are going to manage that, because the central bank is also not taking it very seriously, because their prudential regulation is more concerned about the credit risk. Whereas when we look at, when we Google this IFRS 9 implementation in the world, the people are talk about the counterparty risk more than the loaning side, because the factor might be that the regulator is also regulating that aspect that pertains to the credit risk. So this is my question, how we are going to tackle that, the counterparty risk in our ECL model?
I think counterparty risk is the, to my understanding, is the risk that is also the credit risk.
When we look at the balance sheet of a bank, there are two major components on a balance sheet side, asset side. One is the investment, that we have investment in the other issuer entities. And yep. The other one is that we are lending, the loans we have.
So you're talking about...
We are talking the loans is all about the credit risk we have talked about, because we have internal rating risk assessment in the bank, based on which they are rating the clients, and based on their rating they are deciding the pricing.
So
But what about that the investment we have made? I have investment in ICI. And the, what about what we are, how we are catering if an organizational setup is beyond Pakistan jurisdiction, like there are so many banks who have presence out of Pakistan. So how they have a consolidated ECL model that cater all of these?
Well, the ECL model also applies to the debt securities, right? The difference is, in most of the cases, the debt securities are externally rated. So you do not rely solely on your internal credit models, but you take the credit rating externally from external sources, and based on that, you predict the probability of default. In some cases, the probability of default is also provided by the rating agencies based on the profile of the debt securities. So it is applicable to the debt securities as well, and for equity, we are mostly at a fair volume model. So
that's.
Yes.
So most of the investing companies we have, they don't actually rated by FATCA. So what is the parameter we are going to utilize?
I think most of the debt most of the debt instruments that we have, TFCs, etc., are all rated. But if you're talking about the equities, listed equities, then that is a fair value model altogether. We don't care about the ECL on that.
I mean, all that gets taken care of when you're fair valuing that instrument. And all these investee instruments that you're talking about are in any case at the fair value sitting on the balance sheet. And hence all these matters of the counterparty risk in the equities are already included when you assess the fair valuation of these instruments. The value today is based on all the future expectations that you have, which go into when you determine what is the fair value. So if you have a company that you have a greater risk of defaulting tomorrow, the equity value today will be depressed automatically because of that expectation built into today's fair value.
All right. So
if you see a balance sheet...
Adnan Saab had a question. I think that's...
I have a few observations, and maybe you can respond to that accordingly. I think one of the issues that I see is that Pakistan is a triple C rated company, country, which means that there is a very high level of volatility here. So in terms of interest rate, we are looking at from 5% to 18%. In terms of default, I think the lowest default in a bank is 1%, which is Al Habib, and then we had one of the highest defaults in NIB, which was like 40%. So I think basing everything on judgment would be very, very tricky. I mean, then of course, as everybody has also pointed out, we do not have historical data. So while the banks have a lot of information with them, it's not in a form that it can be read, collated, and analyzed. I think one of the ways to leapfrog this is to actually see if we can get into a process whereby through the central bank and SCCP, we actually get a lot of companies rated. At the moment in Pakistan, there are only about like 500 companies, or 450 companies which are rated. and you need to have this portfolio extended to SMEs and other corporates. And that would then give you the judgmental side will start to clarify. Otherwise, each individual accountant, each individual financial controller, each individual banker's assessment is going to be very, very different. So anyway, my comments,
Observation, sir. I think you're very right that we have quite a lot of data, but it is not in a form that can readily be used. But there is another thing that we should also not forget. When we say that we have only 450 companies which are rated about the same, so mostly these are those companies who are exposed to certain levels of debts. Very few SMEs are included in that. But I think all this will come in when we'll also handle the issues like Benamis linked with all these issues. So how much our economy really is the formal economy, how many entities are really dealing into the formal economy, that is what I personally believe is a very big constraint why this whole the number is not really expanding, which over a period of time should be much broader compared to what it is right now.
Secondly, if we look at the sovereign rating which you have mentioned, sovereign rating is much more to do with our macroeconomic situation at the outside view of Pakistan in terms of foreign currency. In terms of rupee, yes, there are challenges, there are non-standardization issues. We at time when we were serious about, our regulator was serious about implementing Basel II for capital calculation, this challenge came at that time as well. We asked our regulator to support us in terms of externally rating these corporate and SME portfolios and have some company formed in that regard. But that didn't happen, and it actually was told at that time, and it happens generally in the global economy as well, that we have to make our internal model more robust. So this is the reason, yes, there is no standardization, but this is a starting point. And everyone has to meet certain minimum regulatory or model related requirements to make those results more consistent and standard.
Okay, so I think let's take another question. Anyone?
Assalamu alaikum. The question is mainly directed to Faraz sir because he is from the banking side rather than the accountancy firm. During the gap assessment process of IFRS 9 in banks, we see that the core banking system in banks in Pakistan today does not support the database that is required for the implementation. So how do you see the overhauling of the system based database, and how do you see that accountancy firm who in advisory function has supported you in the process have to build up their capacity in this regard?
See, the bigger challenge I was talking about at that time when I was presenting is the availability of data. Yes, you have rightly mentioned that core banking system carries a limited set of transactional data. But you see, in majority of the banks now, we have loan origination systems. In those loan origination systems, we capture the entire financial and non-financial information of the customers. And we do ratings no matter how simple or sophisticated they are. We capture the ratings in the system, and we need to do it consistently, and we will be doing it now because this is not only related to IFRS 9, but now banks has realized that better risk assessment, better risk management require necessary data histories. So loan origination systems becomes important, core banking system become important, and the most important thing is to have a centralized database in terms of a data warehouse or a data repository where you should capture the data, and you should have a 360 degree view of a customer right at the initiation stage. And every year when you review the loan facility and reapprove it, you need to have the complete data, because while assessing the probability of default, you need to create a relationship that if default happens, what went wrong with the financial statement. So there are systems which generally are available in the banks. It is the structuring of that data, preserving the data, and then using the data in the meaningful manner.
Okay, so I think unfortunately the time is limited, and we have to then wrap this panel discussion. Thank you so much, all of you, and Now over to Sarah.
I'll request everybody to stay on stage, and I'll request Farooq Rehman Saab to come on stage so that we can give the mementos to our speakers of the first half. First memento is for Zulfikar Akhtar. Second goes to our second speaker, Arsalan Khalid, and our moderator for this session. Third speaker of the day was Mr. Faraz. Our fourth speaker was Amin Malik. Thank you, everyone. Now, lunch and tea break. We'll have namaz arrangement for the men at poolside and for the ladies in the executive boardroom. In the interest of time, you're requested to please assemble back in 45 minutes by 2:15. So there's a request just to cut down the break by 15 minutes so that we can manage the rest of the session. Thank you so much.